address.
Thank you.
Jananim Sharadam Devi Ramakrishnam Jagadgurum Padapadme Tayor Shritva Pranamami Murmuho Ratnakara Dhautapadam Himalaya Kiritinim Brahma Rajarshi Ratnatyam Vande Bharatamataram. Respected dignitaries on the dais and off the dais, my dear students, my humble pranams to you all. It's really a pleasure to be here, and I'm very happy today because my heart is filled with joy unspeakable, because after 68 years we are celebrating Ekta Divas and Jayanti of Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel. It took us 68 years to come till here. Today everybody says it's a black day, but the whole India is brightened today with Sardar's ideologies, Sardar's ideas. I'm very happy, and I congratulate Government of India, in particular Human Resource Development Department, which insisted and made it compulsory to all the universities to celebrate this, and I'm very, very much happy for this occasion. I'm coming from a university called Hampi University, a Kannada university, where they never saw Sardar Patel's photograph. They were searching here and there yesterday. They searched and they got the photograph of Sardar, and I asked them, why, what are you doing? Why are you doing all those things? They said, we have got strict rules from UGC. We have to celebrate Sardar Patel's Jayanti, and we are doing for that. I said, wonderful. Government has done a great thing. At least today, we are looking into us. I always talk about this, looking into us. What is that? This is a thing I always wonder. History of India is written by foreigners. They invaded us, starting from Greeks, Shaks, Huns, and then Turks, Arabs, and then came Portuguese, French, Dutch, English, and even Pakistan and China did not leave us. Everybody attacked us. Every time when somebody attacks, two things happens. First, if we win, our self-confidence will be developed. If we lose, we will lose our culture. India was ruined for 1,000 years. They ruled us for 1,000 years. And after 1,000 years, India again stood strongly. It was Britishers. I always wonder. I'm very keen observer of that. It is Britishers who had full knowledge of how to rule others. When they came to India, they already ruled America. They had already ruled Australia, and they destroyed America and Australia. They established themselves there, and then they came to India. When they came to India, they thought they can rule India also in the same manner. They can destroy the whole of India, and then they can establish themselves here, and they can do anything they want. But India was in a different case. It was not America, it was not Australia, it was very much different. Then they thought, we cannot eliminate Indians. We cannot eliminate indigenous people here. So what we can do is, we can change the mindset of Indians. If we can change the mindset of Indians, then they are no more Indians. They become Britishers. Then we need not stay here. They will stay here and they will destroy India. They thought this. And they worked on this. I'm working on this from past 15 years. I had been to Dharmpalji. I was with him. Dharmpalji was a great Gandhian. And he was a great historian also. Once he was on his tour from Gwalior to Delhi. He usually had a habit of traveling in a general bogey, not like us in AC bogies. He used to travel in general bogies. When he was traveling, he saw some people who came all the way from South India, and they were traveling to Haridwar. He asked them, where are you coming from? They said, we are from South India. We traveled all the Tirthaya, we did all the Yatras, and we are going to Haridwar. He simply asked, don't you see Delhi in between? Don't you see Mumbai in between? Then they said, no, we don't have time for that. We just go to Haridwar, we just pray pranams, we just do pranams to Ganga Maya, and we come back, that's all. He said, you don't have time to see Delhi? We have built so many buildings there, we have so many flyovers there, we have so many colleges there, and you don't see Delhi, you are going to Haridwar. Then they said, no, this is our Yatra time, this time we only see Haridwar, and next time if we get time,
Then we'll go to Delhi and we'll see Delhi. Then he understood the current of India is different. It is not that what we are thinking. It is not that what we are studying. The current undercurrent of India is something different. He understood that. Then he went to Europe. Then he studied 18th century documents. And then he came out with great ideas. And he said, India is different. That what we are seeing today is not the real India. He was quoting. I was very fascinated by that statement. He was telling, if you see India from European eyes, you can never see India. You can neither see India nor Europe. You have to see India by Indian eyes only. So please understand these statements. Underline these statements. So when you wear some goggles, chashma aap pehente ho, lal color ka chashma aap pehen ke mujhe dekhte ho, to main lal dikhunga. Agar aap blue color ka chashma pehen ke mujhe dekhte ho, to main blue dikhunga. In fact, I am neither blue nor lal. I am neither blue nor red. I am Chakravarthy as it is. So the problem of India is we are wearing European glass and looking at India and we say India is not good. We are wearing European American glass and we are looking at India and we say India is not good. For God's sake, remove your glasses and wear Indian glasses and look at India. Then you will see the real India. That was Dharmapalji was saying. So on this basis, I always think, what is the education? So long back, one commemoration was there in Tibet. Many educationists were there. Even Dharmapalji was there. So then Rinpoche was there. Rinpoche means he's a Buddhist Lama. So he was there. So when education is sat, Dharmapalji asked, what is education? Then he said, education is education, that's all. What we teach is education. Then Dharmapalji kept quiet. Afterwards, Rinpoche came and told, all these days, for four days, what you discussed is laukik education. The real education is the prajnana, the viveka, the wisdom that you must get. That is real education, which you are not giving. And that was given by India. Please go to India and understand what education is. This was told by a Tibetan monk, and he was in Tibet. But Indians, we never came across these things, and that was the real problem. And it took us 68 years. Now we have a prime minister, he goes to Japan and he gifts a Bhagavad Gita and says, this is the best gift India can give to the world, and this is the only gift world can receive from India, and this is the best I can give you. So this, now we are saying, he goes to America and he gifts a Bhagavad Gita and says, this is the best gift America can receive from India. So we are happy now. So there is a paradigm shift in Indian thinking. This shift actually was started, or actually was in a full mood, full swing, when Sardar Patel was there. Sardar Patel is my favorite hero. Sir asked me, why you wrote on Sardar Patel? I say, whenever I see political leaders, my ambition or my kalpana, main aise sochta hun, agar koi political leader ho to Sardar Patel ji jaisa ho. You know, he is a man of sacrifices. At the young age, he wanted to do LLB, but his elder brother, Vittalbhai Patel, he told, I want to do LLB now. He just left everything. He started working. He looked after elder brother's family, his family, and he saved little money. But he had a burning instinct to do LLB. What he did? He just joined to college, never went to college. His brother was regularly going to college and he took 4 years to complete LLB, and this man never went to college, and within 3 years he got LLB degree. Sometimes college students call me and say, Anna, now kashtapattu odidru yenu artha agodilvalla namage. I say, kashtapattu odidde problem, ishtapattu yak odudilla anta. So this is the problem. What we do is we struggle hard. We never love what we do. Once we love what we do, I think we can go into deeper. That's what Sardar teaches us. He loved to become a lawyer. And he became such a lawyer, he never lost a case. Almost, he never lost a case. He got a lot of money. He got fame. He got everything he had. But he had a burning instinct again. He wanted to go to London and have a barrister degree. London barrister degree. But his brother again came and told, however, I have got a degree now. I am a lawyer here. I want to go to London. So you please stay here. He said, fine. Whatever he saved, he gave it to his elder brother and he stayed back. His brother went to London and he got a degree. But this man stayed here. He sacrificed. My dear friends, when Gandhiji came into the picture, he left everything. He wore a khadi dress and he went behind Mahatma Gandhiji. The age gap between, age difference between Gandhiji and Sardar Patel was not much more than 6 years. Gandhiji was 6 years elder than Sardar Patel, that's all, not more than that. But he went to Gandhiji, he sat before Gandhiji, whatever Gandhiji told, this man worked out. Gandhiji had a stronghold in Gujarat because of Sardar Patel. Gandhiji's non-cooperation movement had a greater impact on India because of this man. Gandhiji from Gujarat, Gandhiji grew up to the level of India because of this man. But this man never came in front. And you know what happened at the end? By 1946, April, there was an election for Congress presidents. Who would be the next Congress president? Everybody thought it should be Sardar Patel because he is an iron man. He can lead India to the greater heights. But there was a competitor and that was Jawaharlal Nehru. Everybody knew 1946, April, that election was there. And who would be who they select as the chairman of the Congress, he would be the prime minister, next prime minister. So everybody thought we will vote Sardar Patel. Many requested Jawaharlal Nehru to take back his contendership, but Jawaharlal Nehru never agreed. Election held, you can't believe, out of 15 votes, Sardar Patel got 13 votes. Even Nehru's province, that working committee member, he never voted Nehru. The matter came to Gandhiji. Gandhiji saw it. Nehru told, this was again Dharmpalji's words, Nehru told, if you don't make me president now, I will divide Congress and I will make another Congress. Already India is at the verge of dividing. One is Hindustan and another is Pakistan. Now we are going to divide again. So when this matter came, Gandhiji requested him, Sardar, sirf itna hi. Sardar ne kaha, theek hai, main peeche reh jaunga. He is the man of sacrifices, my dear friends. He sacrificed prime ministerial post just because Mahatma told him not to take that post. But Mahatma insisted him to become Graha Mantri of this country. And because of him, at least we saved this much of India. Many of us, we never know, when India was divided, that was Hindustan and Pakistan. And in Hindustan, there were 565 states. 565 states. So all the kings, they wanted, according to the rule, either they have to join Pakistan, or they have to be with India, or they can even be independent. And if I am a king, what I would think? I would say I will be independent. I would love to be independent. If every 565 states, if they say I would love to be independent, then India would have been divided into 565 pieces. Sardar went to Mountbatten and Sardar told, laughingly he said, I want a fruit basket. When you give freedom, when you transfer the power, I want a fruit basket with 565 apples in it. One less, I don't accept. This was the words of Sardar. Then he was very shrewd. Sardar was very shrewd. He never kept his foot back. So what Sardar did was, he met all the princely kings. He called them to house. When the princely king comes to the house, he just goes there. He just welcomes him in a grand fashion. And he takes him to the lunch table. There he used to discuss of all these things. If you keep alone, if you be alone, if you have an independent status, what would happen to you? He explains everything. And before the lunch ends, the Raja will say, I would join India. This was the way he was working. So all the 565 states, almost all, up to 562 states, he made them to join India. Sab log mil gaye. Mujhe lagta hai sirf Bhopal wale thoda hichkicha rahe the. Bhopal ne kaha, I will not join. And then Bikaner and these people, they said, we will immediately join India. And this Tiruvankur Raja, he said, no, we will be independent. So there were some problems, but he managed everything. Only three left, Pal plus Junagadh, Hyderabad and Kashmir. If I say this, many will wonder, Sardar was never interested in Kashmir because Kashmir was highly populated by Muslims ruled by a Hindu king. Junagadh was highly populated by Hindus ruled by a Muslim king. At the same manner, Hyderabad was highly populated with Hindus ruled by Nawab. He said, we will take Junagadh and Hyderabad. We will not worry about Kashmir. Jinnah did not keep quiet. He poked his nose in Junagadh. He said, since Junagadh's Raja is a Muslim and we want Junagadh also to be a part of Pakistan. When Jinnah entered into this matter, Sardar Patel immediately went to Junagadh and he made Junagadh to join India. And then he went to Raja Hari Singh of Kashmir. He requested him, or when Kashmir's Raja, he came to Sardar Patel and he said, even I want to join to India. Then immediately he sent our military and he got Kashmir into fold of India. The left one is Hyderabad. Many of us don't know, when we celebrate independence, that was on August 14th or 15th, we celebrate independence, but Hyderabad, Karnataka, or the Hyderabad itself, they celebrate independence on another day, that is September 17th. Hyderabad came to us. Hyderabad joined India almost after 1 year. 1 year, 1 month, and 2 days. Sardar was waiting. Hyderabad's Nawab was in close contact with Jinnah. Jinnah was sending regularly arms to Hyderabad. Hyderabad was filled with some Razakars who were hating Hyderabad or who wanted to join to Pakistan. Sardar waited for 1 year. When we had a strong foothold in India, then Sardar called military personnel and he asked them to attack Hyderabad. That was called Operation Polo. Razakar's leader, Qasim Rajvi, he came to Sardar and he ordered or just he spoke to Sardar. Sardar ko usne kaha, agar aap log hamare upar sainya bhejte ho, aap log hamare upar war ke liye kisi ko bhejte ho, till our last breath we'll fight. You know what did Sardar say? Agar aap suicide karna chahte ho to kar lo, mujhe isme kuch lena dena nahi hai. Main to tayyar hu. These were the words. When he was speaking, his words were in this fashion. That's why people say he was very shrewd. Wo kuch bhi kehta tha, wo karke dikhata tha. Isiliye usko Iron Man kaha jata tha. Lord Mountbatten kehta hai, agar mujhe partition ke issue ke bare mein Nehru ke bajaye Sardar se baat karna hota, to Bharat kabhi divide hi nahi hota. होने ही नहीं देता सरदार पटेल. मुझे नेहरू से बात करना मिला इसीलिए भारत को डिवाइड कर पाया, लेकिन सरदार से बात करना इतना आसान नहीं था. ही वॉज आयरन मैन ऑफ इंडिया. तो ऑपरेशन पोलो हुआ, मिलिट्री के जनरल्स आके उन्होंने बात किया. दे स्पोक टू सरदार एंड दे टोल्ड, नाउ इट इज नॉट द टाइम टू अटैक हैदराबाद, वी शैल वेट फॉर अनदर ईयर. सरदार टोल्ड, नो, मॉरली वी आर ऑन हाई ग्राउंड्स, नाउ वी हैव टू अटैक. And within 48 hours, we'll get back Hyderabad. I'll promise you, don't worry. They went ahead. And within 24 hours, Hyderabad was with us. And Nawab bowed his head in front of Sardar Patel and told, I'm extremely sorry, I'm leaving India. So Hyderabad came to us just because of Sardar. Agar Hyderabad nahi hota, to socho, Bharat ke niche bhi ek Pakistan hota, to Bharat ka halat kya hota? एक पाकिस्तान, उससे डिवाइड हुआ और एक बांग्ला, इसको ही हमसे बर्दाश्त नहीं हो रहा है. अगर नीचे भी एक पाकिस्तान होता तो भारत का हालत क्या होता. तो सरदार सेव्ड इंडिया एंड यूनाइटेड इंडिया. दैट्स व्हाई टुडे इट इज कॉल्ड द डे ऑफ यूनिटी. इफ एट ऑल इंडिया इज इन दिस फैशन, दैट इज जस्ट बिकॉज ऑफ सरदार. तो सो वेन एवर आई थिंक ऑफ सरदार इन दिस फैशन, आई से वंडरफुल. सरदार का तो काम बहुत था, लेकिन the worst part is India never heard Sardar. Sardar warned China is in the grip of communists, coming into the grip of communists. One day they will catch hold of Tibet. Be careful. Nehru told, no, communists are very good people. They have very good relations with the whole world. They will never do this thing. Within some day, China came and China engulfed Tibet. Then he warned, Chinese armies were almost 1,000 kilometers away from India. Now they are into the border. It's very dangerous. Be careful when handling with China. Nehru told, no, Hindi chini bhai bhai hai. And China attacked. We lost miserably. We lost our almost 3,500 soldiers on that fight. And even today, if we ask anybody, if we say, can we fight with China? We say, no, we can't. Because morally, we are dead. Once I asked Subramanian Swami, a veteran leader, I asked him, sir, can we fight with China? He said, why can't? Do you know why we fight with Pakistan? Why we fight with, then he said, we are morally on high, so we fight with Pakistan and we win every time. Pakistan is morally 100% down. So every time they fight with us, with more weapons, with more, modern weapons, and they lose the war because they are morally down. Once we are morally high, we can control the whole world. These were the words of Subramanian Swami, and now I am realizing it. We have a prime minister. When he took oath, China was thinking he has to come to China first. Because we are the most irritants to India. They have to come to first to China and beg us. If Prime Minister of India has to go to China and beg, please give me 5 years. I'll develop, I'll do some work in India. Till then, you please don't disturb us. He would have asked that. But our Prime Minister, he is following Sardar Patel. He went to Bhutan first. I know many of us, even today, doesn't know where Bhutan comes. You please go to your atlas and just look at it, where Bhutan comes. Bhutan is adjacent to China and it's our neighbor. He went to Bhutan and Bhutan people were so happy that they told, we are culturally very much close to India and we will be with India always. So one of neighbor of China told, we will be with India. And then China thought, next at least he'll come to us. He went to Nepal. Nepal is again adjacent to China. He went to Nepal and Nepal's Raja was so happy. Nepal's opposition party leader, he just screamed. I don't understand whether he is a prime minister of India or Nepal. The people are so happy to welcome him. I don't understand what's happening. He was screaming. And Nepal said, we are culturally close to India. How can we go to China? We will be with you. At least now he'll come, China was thinking. He went to Japan. Because Japan, in between Japan and China, there is an island called Senkaku. Both are fighting for that. He went there and he said, whenever any trouble comes to you, we are there for you. China told, whenever trouble comes to you, we are there for you. And both are facing troubles from China itself. So now China was really in trouble. Chinese premier, he told, however, I'm going to Sri Lanka. While returning, I'll just come to India. He only came to India. And he sat with us. He went to Gujarat. He sat with our prime minister. He spoke there. So while going back, what he did was, he sent his military into our territory. Now, what we have to do? India just made a treaty with Vietnam and told, we will dig your oil well, which is in problem with China. We will dig there and we will extract oil and we will give you handsome amount. Don't worry, we are with you. Even Vietnam came to us. The same thing 10 years back China was doing with us. China went to Bangladesh, China went to Sri Lanka, China went to Pakistan, China went to Bhutan. China had a hold on all these countries and China engulfed us. Now India is doing the same and saying, morally we are at high now. Now we can fight with China. Don't worry, we are in a strong position. When we go to strong position, nobody will trouble us. There will be no war. When we are weak, there will be war. When we are at the strong position, there will be no war. This is the thought that Sardar Patel gave. That's why I always think, if Sardar Patel was there for next another 10 years, India would have been in a different position. India would have reached a different position. My dear friends, India is now at that mark. I always think and rethink about this. My only aim, some people ask me, what is your aim? Why you are doing all those things? Why you left your BE? Why you are traveling all the length and breadth of state and India? Why you are doing this? I just say them, my only aim is I want to see my India as Jagatguru. The whole world, I want them to bow down in front of my nation and say, India is a great country. This is the only vision I have. Till last some days, I thought by 2020, India would become superpower. India would become Jagatguru. And last 1 week back, I just met a person who had a capacity of controlling atmas. He used to speak to atmas. I had read these in books, and I met such a person, such a saint. He just asked me, "You have any question?" "I have one big question. I think your atmas cannot answer that." And he told, "No, atmas will answer every question." Then I said, "I'll ask a question. Keep the pen there." So he had a peculiar type of working. He keeps a plain paper and keeps a nimbu, a lemon there. On the lemon, he writes my name and keeps a pen there. He covers it with another paper and he calls atmas and he asks me what the questions you have. I just asked him whether Bharat would become Jagadguru. Point one. And the second question was, would I see that? Or mere photo pe har lag jayega. Kya hoga? Pucho isko. To usne pucha atmas hai. And it was interesting. After hardly 30 seconds, he gave that blank paper to me. There was written, 6-7 lines were written. It was interesting. I saw it through my eyes. And there it was written, aap dekhoge, Bharat jab Jagadguru banega, aap rahoge, chinta mat karo. And second was, he said, by 2017, you will see world bows in front of India, that you will see. I was happy. I was dancing. I said, I thought it was 2020 and now it's becoming in 2017. So within another 3 years, we are going to do this. So then I thought, so India is awakening. Bharat jagrat ho raha hai. Humko pata chal raha hai. Swachh Bharat aya, to hum sab ek ek broomstick haath mein liye, hum sab raste pe a gaye. Hum sab jhadu lagane lage. Kya maza a gaya hoga? Socho is desh ke mantri the, lal batti ka car leke ghoomte the, aaj unity run ke naam pe bhag rahe. Is desh ke mantri the, jo bahut paisa kama ke baithe the, aaj wo haath mein ek broomstick leke jhadu laga ke dikhte. To aise shift aapne kabhi socha bhi nahi hoga, is desh mein ho raha hai. To mujhe lagta hai Bharat ka acche din zarur aane wala hai, zarur aa gaya hai. To the changes are coming, the world is looking at India in a different angle. So now I request you, now we have to look ourselves in a different way. That's what I always say. Science mein ek kaha jata hai, how the history was written. Europe saw us as an object. They were subjects and we were objects. And object ke baare mein hum kaise likhte hai, waise hi humare history ke baare mein likha. Ab alag hona hai. I am the object and I am the subject. Mere baare mein main likhunga. Mere baare mein main dekhunga. Isko adhyatma kaha ya kahan gaya is desh mein. Jis adhyatma ko humne socha, jiske baare mein alochna ki, us adhyatma ke baare mein Bharat ko fir se jagrat karna hoga. Ek baar yuva iske baare mein sochne lagenge, to ek naya Bharat is desh se nikal ke aayega. Us naya Bharat mein shwas lena, us naya Bharat mein pani peena, us naya Bharat mein khana khana, kitna maza aata hoga. Ab thoda socho. Isliye, I conclude my words with Swamiji's those statement. Swamiji wrote a letter to Swami Vivekananda, wrote a letter to Alasinga Perumal probably in 1893, before September 11. He said, I want young men. I want 100,000s of young men. And he writes, men, not the brutes. I want 100,000s of young men with the zeal of lion's heart, with muscles of iron, nerves of steel, those who can bleed for the poor, the ignorant, the downtrodden. And those who travel length and breadth of the country to preach the gospel of help, the gospel of salvation, the gospel of equality, the gospel of unity. Agar aise log 100,000 mujhe mil jaye, to main ek naya Bharat nirman karunga. This was the words of Swami Vivekananda. Just one question I have to ask. Are you one among those 100,000s? If you are one among them, please come us. Let us join. Let us make a unified India, a strong India. Aise India ko banayenge, to duniya dekhte dekhte nazar jhuka ke baitha rahega. Agar aise India ho sakta hai, to Bharat nirman hoga. Aise Bharat ko hum sab nirman karenge. Aise sochte huye, I thank one and all. Thank you very much. Vande Mataram. Jai Hind.